Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Retired S-Ranked Adventurer, Volume 3, by Wolfe Locke and James Falcon. Narrated by Sierra Kline. Chapter 1. 3 days gone. Sven stood in front of Galen's grave as the sun set behind the mountains, his thoughts turning to life and death. Even after everything that had happened, the death of a friend didn't stop weighing on him. Another comrade gone, another friend. And it wasn't like he had that many left to begin with. In that moment, he felt more alone than he had ever been. The endless gaping hole that yearned for his friend, the once leader of the guild, roiled in his stomach. He pursed his lips as he stared down at the dirt, wishing for anything that could bring his friend back. But he couldn't. And so, he let himself be vulnerable, allowing that loneliness to bloom as he mourned. The loneliness was one where you could be surrounded by others, but nobody truly saw you. One that made you wish to call out, to cry for help, but you didn't. Alone. And he would have believed that he was alone, too, if it weren't for Ash. He looked behind him to see the recruits gathering in the field outside of the adventurer's rest. Lloyd had prepared a quick dinner while Ash rested. Sven's gaze meandered toward the tavern, towards the enchantment. The enchantment on the tavern had worn off. Thankfully, no one had given chase. Sven had been worried, his jaw aching from how hard he clenched it. But he hadn't been afraid. However, even though he was unafraid, he'd been hesitant.
It's one thing to fight or to slay a monster. But the soldiers the kingdom sent against us were still people. They had lives, friends, and families.
He looked back toward Galen's grave.
As long as I could avoid it, I couldn't bring myself to kill them. If I had, they'd be standing in front of a grave, too.
Sven sighed and gripped his hands in frustration.
But I might not have that luxury in the future.
In the distance, Montesquieu blew a returner's whistle. Sven watched as Montesquieu's horse appeared out of thin air, albeit confused and fearful-looking. Sven nodded appreciatively as he watched Montesquieu place a careful hand on the horse's snout, whispering soft words until the horse's nervousness abated.
I'm glad your master didn't have to leave you behind.
Montesquieu led the horse away and let it graze, lavishing in the quiet and cool of the mountains. Its tail idly swished side to side to fend off the overgrown mountain flies. The trusty steed looked happier than it had ever been back in the inn stable. He winced, thinking about all the money he'd paid for the land they'd been forced to leave behind. If they ever returned to their old location, he'd make sure to keep a pasture for the animals. They'd been on the mountain for 3 days now, recovering from the battle with the lamplighters. Sven had spent most of that time deep in contemplation, going over the events of Galen's life, solidifying them into some kind of coherent story that he could tell other people.
I'll not let you be forgotten, old friend.
Galen the brave. Galen the complicated. Galen the guy who grew up poor and decided he'd never live that way again. Thinking of his friend's life helped Sven keep his mind off the other, much larger problem.
What happened to me?
Sven wasn't positive what the guildmaster had done to draw the attention of whatever, or whomever, had managed to curse him, though he had a few ideas.
Whatever it was, it had to be bad, and it had to do with me.
That weight crushed him, making every breath heavy and disheartened. But whatever it was, Sven guessed it was going to have some pretty serious repercussions for all of them down the road.
Damn it, Galen. Why didn't you tell me?
He muttered, crouching low. He wanted to rant, to rave, to vent his frustrations. But there was no point in getting angry at the dead. Galen couldn't do anything to fix it now, no matter how much Sven wished he could turn back time. Hey, Ash muttered shyly as she approached, holding a hot, steaming bowl. She glanced at Galen's grave, then focused on Sven. Still? It's your favorite. Lentil and lamb shanks. He stood as she handed him a rough-hewn wooden bowl. Sven lifted it up with a weary smile and inhaled. It sure did smell delicious.
Lloyd sure does know how to cook. Always has.
Sven's stomach rumbled, and he realized, to his surprise, that he was hungry. Starving, even? How long had it been since Ash had brought him breakfast that morning? He'd been out by the grave all day. "He put extra meat in it for you," she said, noticing how hungry Sven seemed to be. "In addition to all that extra spicy stuff."
"Thanks," Sven muttered, giving her a wry smile. "You know how much I like spicy stuff."
He took a bite, the flavor exploding in his mouth. He tried to savor it, taking another mouthful, and then he inhaled the whole bowl. Lloyd had completely outdone himself this time. He would have to remember to give his compliments to the chef.
"That's a good stew," Sven complimented, wiping away the juices on his lips.
"I can get you more, if you want," Ash offered, clearly trying to improve his mood. He knew she didn't like how down he'd been since Galen's death. His time out by the grave was evidence enough of his mood.
"No," he said, shaking his head and looking toward the tavern. "I'll come back to the adventurer's rest soon, and then we can get going. I'll get more of the stew if there's any left after the others dig in."
He let the bowl hang by his side as he spoke.
"It's about time for us to move on. Physically and metaphorically."
Sven looked back at the grave, giving it a last goodbye glance.
"Yeah, speaking of moving on," she started. "We need to decide what we're going to do next."
"About that. You know where we need to go," Sven replied, eyeing her warily.
"I do," Ash admitted. "But not everyone does. The recruits want to take a vote about where to go. We're starting to run out of food."
"We could hunt," Sven replied absentmindedly, looking off towards the mountains looming in the distance. "Stay up here in the mountains. We could eat deer we hunt, maybe domesticate some of the mountain goats. The adventurer's rest would be a nice shelter for travelers lost in the snow."
Ash made a pained face.
"You really want that?"
"No," Sven said, sighing as he ran his hand through his hair. "But it's one idea."
"We need to be ready, Sven. Things have been set in motion, and we're still playing catch-up," she said, and he couldn't refute. In fact, he very much agreed.
"We have to stop whatever this is. Otherwise, who knows what might happen?"
"I know. But I'm trying to figure out what happened. And not just with Galen," Sven explained.
And Ash's expression softened. She knew exactly what he was talking about.
"We have to go back to the Dreadmoor," Ash stated.
Sven knew there was no avoiding it.
"I know."
He sighed again.
"It would be easier just to stay in the mountains and run an inn. But that would be staying ignorant to what's happened. It would be running away from the problem."
"You know you'd get bored in about 5 minutes, Sven."
She cracked a grin, letting out a short laugh.
"And that's even if there wasn't a super depressing reason to get out of here."
"I don't know,"
Sven said, his gaze wandering toward the mountains and the forests.
"It's pretty here. Quiet, too. Maybe I'll get used to it. It wouldn't be the worst life to live."
But he had to admit that she was probably right. Even as he looked at the sun streaking across the clean mountain peaks on the horizon, he was already moving on.
"It's time for the next challenge."
For better or for worse, Sven had never been able to relax for long. It was one of the things he attributed to his success as an adventurer. She left him to his thoughts, and Sven waited a while longer before turning around and heading back into the tavern to load up on more stew. Lloyd had kept the pot warm on the stove, and he poured out a stein of dark ale when he saw Sven come in.
"How are you doing, boss?"
he asked, looking concerned.
"Is everything all right? We can talk if you want."
Lloyd passed Sven the stein, nodding his head.
"Really, maybe we should talk. A lot has happened in such little time." "I'm fine," Sven said, as he took a swig of beer.
When he finished, he wiped his lip free of the residual liquid, turning to Lloyd.
"I hear we're running out of food. How long do we have?"
Lloyd frowned.
It really depends on what you want to eat. We've got meat for 2 more meals. After that, we could do potato stews for a day or 2 more.
Potato stews? Sven asked, wincing. That's not great.
He took another swig, allowing himself a moment to think. When he finished, he met Lloyd's gaze.
I think we should leave tomorrow. And go where?
Lloyd replied, prompting Sven to explain himself. Sven sighed, chugging the remainder of the beer, and then held out his stein for a refill. Lloyd obliged. Only once Sven took another sip did he speak again.
We need to ask the recruits what they want. And what do you want, Lloyd? Ash and I are going somewhere very dangerous. But there's no reason all of you should have to come along if you don't want to.
He let the implication of that linger. When Lloyd raised a brow, he took another gulp.
Speaking frankly, this will be your chance to part ways with us. I'll go where you go,
the bartender responded without hesitation. He looked toward the door Sven had come from.
But the recruits might not feel the same way as I do. It's good of you to give them the juice. That's why I want them to vote,
Sven responded, following Lloyd's gaze.
It's why I want to clear the air. And truth be told, I've got a lot that needs saying.
Lloyd nodded and started to walk away.
I'll go get them and let them all know this is important. Thanks.
Chapter 2. Team Meeting. Sven sat alone and ate his second bowl of the stew. Though Lloyd had said he was heading to get the recruits, Sven didn't wait for the half-elf to come back. Instead, he ducked back inside for a third helping before retiring back to the front porch. He grimaced as soon as he heard the bartender raising his voice, trying to get the recruits to gather in the main room of the Adventurer's Rest. Sven laughed for the first time as he heard the protests since Galen's death. A real laugh. He didn't envy Lloyd. Dealing with recruits was like herding drowning cats sometimes. Finally, all of the recruits were assembled in the half-destroyed tavern. Most of their chairs were still in splinters, though Zane seemed to have quickly put together Sven's bar stool. They all took a knee or sat down on the floor as Sven sighed and entered after, taking his place so he could address them all. He sat down and looked around at who remained, wishing that Galen had survived. There was Xenox, the basilisk, perched on the edge of the bar. Ragdoll, a stocky orc warrior sitting cross-legged, back propped up against the far wall. Valindra Oliberos, a live elf with a talent for magic. He'd seen Ash giving her private lessons after group training was done. Crozang, the goblin archer who went nowhere without his bow. Montesqui, the noble boy, stood in the door, keeping one eye on his still grazing horse. And finally, Zane. The poor and scrappy boy from the cobbles who'd been selected by the guild.
Or at least I'm guessing.
In part to appeal to him. The boy was a pickpocket, a thief, a gutter snipe, and one of the best recruits Sven had. Whatever reason Galen had had for assigning him to the training course, Sven was glad he had. A handful of other adventurers pressed in to hear what he had to say. Ash leaned against the wall at the back of the tavern, her usually cheery face drawn long in worry. Lloyd took his usual place behind the bar and remained quiet. Everyone was clearly waiting for Sven to speak.
Hi, everyone,
he said, after a quick, embarrassed cough. His voice resounded strangely in the absolute silence.
I know we've been a little absent lately. Sorry about that. We had a lot happen all at once, and I had some personal issues to sort out.
He paused, looking over the crowd. He met their gazes as he began speaking once more.
I want you all to know you fought bravely the other night. No one could have done better, and you have yourselves to thank for that. You did the work, and you put in the time. The training program helped, but your heart did the rest.
He let out a sigh, preparing himself for what came next.
I've got no doubt you'll all go far, no matter what, so thanks for that.
They all looked at him expectantly. He knew he was avoiding the thing they actually needed to talk about. A part of him wondered what he'd do if they all decided to abandon the adventurer's rest. He wondered if they'd leave behind what he'd tried to start here, to go their own ways once they heard what he was planning. The fear that would leave just him, Lloyd, and Ash to face whatever they found in the Dreadmoor made him drag the conversation on, filling the room with silence. Sven's pause lingered, and the recruits stewed as they waited. He hated the limelight, the attention they gave him, the way they hung on to his every word. But he had to speak. He had to continue.
"We have to leave this mountain," he went on, no longer allowing himself pause. "I talked with Ash earlier, and she's right. This has been a good place to rest, clear our heads, and regroup for a while. But it's time to get a move on. Where we're going next, well, it's not going to be safe."
There was curiosity in their gazes, and that surprised him. Their expectant gazes lacked fear, listening to every word he spoke. Without skipping a beat, he continued,
"We need to go to the Dreadmoor. We need to put an end to whatever is going on, whatever is the reason Galen was killed, before it can happen again. But that's not all. There's one more thing. I need to figure out what's going on with me. I hardly know myself, and those answers can be found in the Dreadmoor, I'm sure of it. I need to know if I am him, or if I'm but an imitation of him."
He took a drink and gave them a moment to think about what he said, to let it really sink in. Their eyes gazed back at him, uncertainty warring within.
"If you want to quit, now is the time. I can make sure you end up somewhere safe, so,"
he said finally, looking at each of them again.
"Who's with me? Who will fight alongside me?"
No one responded, and he immediately felt his stomach drop. The loneliness came back in full force, demanding him to acquiesce to it.
"They aren't coming."
Well, he couldn't say he was surprised. It was to be expected after everything they'd just seen. He'd have to figure out a way to do things on his own. He looked down at the bar counter, thinking. If he and Ash worked together...
"I'm with you, Shatterfist."
It was Zane who'd spoken. Sven looked up to see Zane standing there, staring back at him with resolve in his eyes. The boy stood, proclaiming his allegiance with an unshakable look in his eyes that Sven had never seen before.
"I'll come with you guys,"
he said, nodding toward Ash and Lloyd.
"I want to help however I can."
"Me too."
Xenox, the basilisk, jumped off of his perch on the edge of the bar.
"I'll join,"
Ragdoll said, standing with a groan after brushing off a knee.
"And us," Valindra Oliberos said, with Crozang the goblin at her side.
When he looked their way, they both nodded. All eyes turned to Montesquieu. The young noble was still standing in the doorway, looking uncertain. He glanced outside at his horse, then back to the others.
"I'll come, Shatterfist," he said finally. "After everything you've done for me, it's the least I can do." "You know I'm in, Sven,"
Lloyd said.
"Wouldn't miss it. Working at the rest is the most action I've seen in ages."
"Guess that's that. Looks like we're all going to the Dreadmoor," Ash said, almost sounding excited. "When can we start?"
"We'll spend the night here,"
Sven stated, addressing the gathering.
"Get a good night's sleep. We'll set out at first light. Recruits, be sure you get some rest tonight. We don't know what we're going to find when we get where we're going."
Chapter 3. Travel-sized memorial. After the short meeting, they all parted ways. The recruits went back to their temporary lodgings, and the adventurers went back to nursing drinks. Sven, Ash, and Lloyd huddled on the bar, trying to plan the next part of the journey.
"This might help,"
Lloyd muttered as the half-elf pulled out an ancient map from within his spatial pouch. They all gathered around it as he spread the faded parchment for them to all see.
"For starters, we need to avoid anywhere the lamplighters or the army is likely to be," Ash said with a twirl of her staff. "Those guys ruined a good thing for us."
"Yeah, I wasn't exactly happy with that either, but I wasn't willing to hurt them too badly,"
Sven responded as Ash pouted and Lloyd looked away.
"Anyways,
I think if we take the southern route through the wastes, we should be able to move without any issues. It's only inhabited by monsters, mostly doomcrawlers and sandworms, if I recall correctly. They'll keep us away from the lamplighters and maybe help the rest of our party gain a few levels.
Sven stopped and looked at Ash, not wanting to put her in a bad position.
Ash, do you think you can make the adventurer's rest walk again?
Can I? The mage grinned, twirling her staff excitedly. Seeing her in her element made Sven smile. What kind of mage would I be if I couldn't do a simple golemizer transport spell?
I don't know,
Sven responded earnestly.
I've got most of my memories back, but I don't know anything about that stuff.
Sven saw Lloyd shift uneasily, and the ghost of a frown started to spread on Ash's face.
I need to fix that. Time to change the subject. And didn't you call it something else last time?
Is this really the right time to question how I do my magic, mister? Ash responded with a teasing laugh. But yes, I can do it.
We'll need to get supplies on the way, too, Lloyd said. Otherwise, we'll be stuck in the Dreadmoor with nothing to eat once we get out there.
Ash nodded. If we stop by a village on the way, I can probably magic you guys a good disguise. It might not last long, especially not if I'm also running the spell in the tavern in the background, but it should hopefully give you enough time to buy some food for everyone, at least. Well, you should be fine, unless you run into somebody that can see through disguises.
Great, Sven said. Let's do that. Any chance of another ale, Lloyd? Sure, but it's a good thing you've made up your mind to leave,
the half-elf responded.
We're on our last keg.
Sven flinched and rolled his head back with a sigh.
It's a good thing we're leaving then. And Sven?
Lloyd called out, not really wanting to have the conversation.
The three of us need to make time to talk about what happened, with you and Galen. You've got pieces of information that I'm missing, and I'm sure I've got pieces you're missing. Ash also has her own set of problems. I'm aware, Sven responded, considering Lloyd's words. That's a good idea. I've a few blanks I'm concerned about, but this isn't the time for that.
The next morning, he got up before dawn to say goodbye to Galen. It was cold so early in the morning, as was common in the mountains. As he clutched his cloak tighter around him and shivered, Sven heard the sound of hooves beating behind him. Montesquieu's horse snorted a greeting as it approached. Its breath made gray clouds in the frigid air. Sven lifted a comforting hand and petted the horse's face before turning back to the grave.
Well, Galen, he said, eyes fixed on the grave. I'm sorry for how things turned out. This is it, I guess.
Is it? A familiar feminine voice asked in an almost hushed whisper. He turned to see Ash. She too was wrapped in a cloak, walking toward him from the tavern entrance. She was barefoot. Sven could only shake his head in disbelief. Ash, she was always something. I was thinking, she said when she caught up with him. I don't know if this is the right place for him. It's too lonely. Galen might have been a lot of things, but a loner wasn't one of them. Sven sighed and looked at the mountains.
She's not wrong. Galen liked being around people. It's why he was such a good guild leader. It's nice here, though. There's good crisp air, a little bit of snow, and a beautiful view.
Yeah, she nodded as she folded her arms. Mister, we both know you know better than that. It's cold here. Galen grew up on a saffron farm.
Sure, but last I checked, there's not that much we can do about it.
Her raised brows and silence made him rethink his prior statement.
Is there?
When she didn't respond, he let out a drawn-out sigh.
Unfortunately, this is where he ended up. We don't always get to choose our final resting place. It says as much in the Adventurer's Creed.
You forget that I'm a mage, Ash responded with a knowing smirk. Part of the mage's creed is that if there's a will, there's a way. He watched as she raised her arms. The cloak fell from her shoulders and dropped to the ground as her hands glowed with purple light while she worked a spell. She put a cloaking finger to the corner of her mouth in deep concentration. A moment later, a large smile spread across her face. Then she shouted out, "Travel-sized memorial," waving a glowing hand. For a moment, it was hard to tell what was happening. Then,
"Is it shrinking?"
Sven said in awe. He never knew such a thing was possible with magic. But then again, he didn't know much of magic at all. Ash nodded.
"I did say travel-sized. I was worried how that would work out."
The two of them watched as Galen's grave began to turn into a miniature version of itself. Sven watched, a little spooked, as a magical glass globe formed around the grave and the dirt underneath it. When it was done, it floated in the air. The entire thing could fit in the palm of his hand.
"It looks like a snow globe?"
he asked. "It does," she asked, as she adjusted her spatial hat so she could see better, squinting.
"Yeah, I guess it kind of does."
She gave it another look.
"Yeah, you're right. Well, he's still in there, just a bit smaller."
The memorial they had made was inside the globe, along with a patch of grass on a miniature hill, and, Sven assumed, Galen's body beneath it. It left a sizable hole in the ground.
"That's something,"
he said, admiring her work.
"We can find a safe place to set it down after we visit the Dreadmoor," Ash said quickly. "Someplace he'd like. The best thing about this is that it can all go back exactly as it was once I reverse the spell."
"Interesting," Sven said.
He'd gotten used to the idea of Galen laying here forever, alone in the mountains. It was a pretty location, but a bleak thought.
Ash was right. Galen would have hated it here.
He picked up the globe she'd made and tucked it under his arm. It was surprisingly heavy for its size. Even with his massive strength, Sven felt strained.
"You're right. Maybe we can find someplace better for him,"
he said. On the horizon, the sun started to rise, and the recruits were starting to stumble out of their room. Montesquieu came out for his horse and led it back to the front porch of the tavern to secure it. The horse gave one last sad look at the mountains. From inside, a pleasant scent drifted on the air.
"Lloyd must have made bacon and eggs."
Sven could hear everyone gathering around the remnants of the fireplace to eat.
"Bye, mountains," Ash said, waving toward the mountains in the distance.
She looked at the area that had been our temporary stop and waved again.
"Bye, rest stop. Next stop, Dreadmoor."
As she started to work the spell, Sven set Galen's snow globe securely on a shelf behind the bar. He assumed it wouldn't shatter, even if it fell off while they were in transit. Ash was careful about that kind of thing. The recruits and adventurers all pounded fists on the table and chanted as the adventurer's rest rose into the air once more, propped up on its long and spindly legs. Although this time, Sven spared a thought for Montesquieu's poor horse. It hadn't seemed happy to be leaving the mountain fields, and a sudden jump in altitude seemed unlikely to help.
"Here we go,"
Lloyd called, holding onto the tavern's glassware in a desperate attempt to keep what was left of it from shattering.
"Help me out here, Sven."
He grabbed two steins in each hand as the adventurer's rest rose up into the air, lifted on wobbly wooden legs, and careened through the mountains at high speed. It felt like they could topple over at any second.
"This feels a little out of control, Ash,"
Sven called, catching another mug as it went flying from a hard bump.
"Was it like this on the way here?"
The magic girl didn't really answer his question when she spoke.
"Sorry, downhill's harder to navigate than uphill. I think things will be better once we level out."
They hung on for dear life until they got off the mountain and out of the snow. Once clear, the adventurer's rest could really stretch its legs. They were moving through a broad and grassy plain. Sven settled into a broken armchair to watch their progress through the window. The chair only had three legs and tilted perilously when he sat down. But if there was one thing he'd learned in life, you can't win them all. Chapter 4. Holdout. The adventurer's rest moved quickly, taking massive strides on animated wooden legs. Sven leaned over the porch railing and watched the scenery. It felt good to clear his head. A lot of things were on his mind, but now that they were actually moving, it was easier for him to compartmentalize and focus on what needed to be done and the things he needed to think about. Ash opened the door and joined him as she leaned against the rail too. She sighed, and Sven could tell something was bothering her. She turned toward him and smiled wearily.
Hey, mister. When we get to the Dreadmoor, promise me that you won't do anything stupid, okay?
Sven turned toward her and held out a hand. Hesitantly, she took it and stepped closer.
I promise. You and I have lost too much time already without me getting into trouble.
She looked up at him, the tip of her spatial hat brushing up against his nose. Sven crinkled his face, and she laughed before pulling away and looking at him with a serious look on her face.
I'm serious, Sven. I lost you once. I couldn't survive that. Not again. Those years of not knowing, of searching, of trying to find a way. They were the worst years of my life, so don't do that to me, okay? Whatever happens, you need to survive.
Leaning forward on pointy shoes, she kissed Sven on the forehead and went back inside. As for Sven, he was left with a quickly beating heart and thoughts towards the future.
I've got most of my memories back, but I need to know everything that's happened. I need to understand what's going on.
With his heart heavy, Sven looked back to the mountains, and the adventurer's rest continued its march.
Don't worry, Ash, he promised. I'll do everything I can to see this through.
They made good time for the rest of the morning, and around noon, they saw the thatched roofs of a small village on the horizon. Trails of smoke rose up from chimney fires. Sven signaled for Ash to stop the adventurer's rest, and with a few waves of her hand, the tavern settled down on its scrawny legs so they could plan their next steps.
Food buying time?
Lloyd asked excitedly, rubbing his hands together.
I've got big plans.
Sven wasn't used to it, but he could practically hear the rumbling of the half-elf's stomach.
Big plans for the Dreadmoor?
Sven asked, not really sure what Lloyd was getting at. Lloyd straightened his back and got serious.
Absolutely. Once we manage to catch our bearings and get ahead of this thing, I'm going to make the biggest feast any of you has ever seen.
With honey bread, right?
Sven asked, not wanting to say what he was thinking.
He seems so sure this is something we can handle.
I'm not sure how much I can do for you guys, disguise-wise,
Ash admitted, and Sven could see the strain of the spell on her.
Keeping the inn going is tapping a lot of my power as is, but I'll do my best. And before you ask, I can definitely cast a teleport spell that'll get you closer to town.
That'd be great. I don't want anyone there to see the rest and report back on us to the lamplighters,
Sven responded, staring at the town ahead.
Leave no trail,
Lloyd said, as he nodded appreciatively.
Galen would have liked that.
Ash clapped her hands together, and a cloud of dense pink smoke filled the room. Sven coughed, and he could hear the recruits doing the same.
Ash, what is this?
Sven yelled out, as it became hard to see, much less breathe.
It's part of the process, she yelled back. Super chameleon!
I'm giving you one more minute,
Ragdoll said from somewhere across the room.
And then I'm opening a window.
Almost finished.
You can't rush an artist, she responded back, grinning. Slowly, the smoke cleared out to reveal what Ash had made. Lloyd now had a patchy beard, red hair, and he wore a threadbare green cloak. Otherwise, he was still recognizably Lloyd, just less elf-like, minus the green and stereotypical cloak.
Nice,
he said, looking down at his new outfit with satisfaction.
Definitely not the worst disguise I've ever seen.
It's a good thing you think so. It's not the best disguise I've ever magicked, Ash admitted. I'd try to move quickly if I were you guys, and I feel like I shouldn't have to say this, but do avoid attracting attention.
Done,
Sven said. He looked in the mirror behind the bar. His stubble was gone, and his hair now fell to his shoulders. Ash had turned his shirt red and given him weird, billowy pants. But the changes didn't feel enough to throw anyone off his trail if they were really looking at him.
I still look like myself. But now it's more like the worst version of myself, as if a child dressed me.
Ash shrugged, but Sven could tell she had a teasing grin.
Like I said, not the best disguise I've ever made. I did my best with what I could spare, guys.
Right,
the two adventurers responded before heading out. The recruits opened all the windows in the bar to clear out the last of the pink smoke. Lloyd had a grocery list folded in his pocket and was grinning while rubbing his hands together, probably dreaming of all the meals he would throw together with the foodstuffs they picked up.
Hey, guys, listen. If you can get the stuff you buy and bring it to the same spot I drop you at, I can transport it back with you, Ash said, looking at them both.
She pursed her lips, staring straight at Lloyd.
But you have to get it there yourself, so don't go too crazy. And if you can't get it back by magic, as in...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.